See, I recently turned 30, and I thought, what a better way to celebrate on this channel than to think of a clickbaity way to talk about behavior analysis. So here's Ryan O's 30 things I learned since getting into behavior analysis. Number one, a science of behavior is possible. It has been possible, it will continue to be possible. Number two, now before you get all excited, just because it is possible doesn't mean that we need to evangelically shove it down people's throats. There's a time and place for technical language and a time and place for plain English. You're going to influence human lives. This should be taken with the utmost respect. Someone is trusting you with a human life. I hope you know exactly what you're doing and have the proper supports in place. If not, mentorship is where it's all at. Until training institutions and supervisors incorporate sufficient science or tools, by the way, that have already been developed, just aren't implemented, your fate is in your hands more than it is in anyone else's, your professors, your supervisors, etc., when it comes to being a well-rounded and effective practitioner. Now, we study some really weird stuff. Al Poling, one of the most prolific and respected researchers, said it himself. Now, some of it's really cool. Some of it has been admittedly esoteric. Some of the solution to today's largest issues that we experience in the field were actually solved decades ago, but we're either too lazy or too inadequately trained to find the materials and resources. Now, it's important that you don't think that I'm blaming you. That's not what's going on here. I'm just saying, ask more seasoned folks and search hard. It's usually not the first Google hit. Now, we live in a capitalistic society. If you think that doesn't influence or affect things, then you are simply wrong. I'm sorry. Money influences, and it affects the way the behavior analytic services are delivered. Acknowledging this is the first step, but if you want a deeper understanding, you'll have to find somewhere other than graduate schools. Currently, that is not a priority for many of these institutions. Now, behavior analysis can't save the world alone. Have you seen a single behavioral technology or issue developed purely by a behavior analyst? Because I sure haven't. Yet I too was told that we are God's gift to the world. We can solve the problems. Going off this notion that behavior analytic skill sets are not enough, you're gonna have to develop some other skills. Maybe things like soft skills, evolutionary biology, just a general understanding of how that works, cultural levels analyses if you're trying to work with groups, technology, the list goes on. Don't freak out. It's a slow game that we're playing here when it comes to self-development and learning more about these things and how behavior ties into these other fields. And I've started an email list actually where when you sign up, the first thing that you get is a summary of some of the things I've been recently reading on these various topics that I suggested that is just absolutely fascinating. And you will never get a promotion, a self-promotion, anything in there. They're only external links. All right. Dissemination, the sharing of our science, is grossly misunderstood. Speaking to behavior analysts isn't dissemination. Maybe it's networking or training, but true dissemination is something that alters the adoption of tools, practices, etc. A great history lesson and an example of what I'm talking about is Catherine Maurice's Let Me Hear Your Voice. It's probably the reason that you ended up in this field and the job that you have now, and it's a great example of dissemination and was not even written by a behavior analyst. As much as we say that we can teach, we sure don't incorporate it into our practices. There's some unicorns out there, but largely things like ASRs, guided notes, and these are just things that are band-aids. They look cool, they feel good. Our field actually created this whole different area of instructional design methodology. And I've yet to see a program, company, or institution implement it based on the research and the rules and best practice. So it's important to know you're going to struggle. It sucks. I know we've all been there. It is not okay, but it is the reality. We have a number of professional organizations that are leading the way, and we must understand that these systems have limitations, which are a byproduct with which they work in. So, as an example, did you know that BACB, our governing body, our board, is accredited by the National Commission for Certifying Agencies? Yes, even the board has limitations on what they can implement, and this NCCA is an example of that. Now, always, this one's so important, always read your contracts, supervision, student loans, employment offers, always read them. I don't care how dubious they may seem, it is your responsibility as an adult, you're signing that piece of paper. Now, non-compete clauses are more frequent than you'd think. I've seen major institutions blatantly lie about not requiring them, ones that I actually had one at the time when they were saying that they no longer included them, like I had an active one that I was a part of. Now, I knew this getting into it, I knew the limitations, just be ready for them. And I've linked below an article by Matt Broadhead describing what you can do if you run into one of these sort of things. Now, we neglect to teach the proper skills for a true behavioral analysis of events. If you want to break into a novel area or start a service or that solves some sort of large issue, you will have to learn more, whether it's things like Mechner notation, RFT, or nonlinear contingency analysis. Know that there is more. In fact, there are over 19 different forms of behaviorism that my colleague and I counted. Your class probably only taught you that there was radical behaviorism and methodological behaviorism. Just know that there is a whole lot more that is out there than what you get. Which brings me to most of the great tools, resources, books, things that are covered in your coursework are designed just to be able to meet the minimum competencies. FA methodology, functional analysis methodology, and its derivatives are treated as gold standards, yet the data aren't as comprehensive as you'd think that they are. We've known forever that there are not a predetermined number of functions. By definition, there are infinite, and its context is extremely important. For more reading, the nonlinear work of Israel Golddiamond, Practical Functional Assessment, or Jack Michaels' Signs of Damage are all linked below in fantastic readings that may blow your mind in this way. All right, manualization of our tools was worn in the past years, 39 years ago to be exact. Yet here we are finding ourselves more than ever constantly in a search for a pre-written protocol. And I don't care what tool it is, if it's the FA, the PFA, ABLES, ABLES-R, VBMAP, PEAK, etc. These are useful tools, but they are not the Bible. Hayes, Rincover, and Solnick in 1980 wrote an article called The Technical Drift of Applied Behavior Analysis in the Journal of Applied Behavior Analysis and warned us that this would happen, and it's only perpetuating. Read up on it. It's a tool, not a crutch. Now, you don't know what you don't know. Behavioral science has a philosophical underpinning in contextualism, and most behavior analysts don't really understand what it is and wholeheartedly adopt it. All right, we are nerdy AF. How nerdy, you may ask? Well, we operationally define love. Now, I genuinely think that most people in our field do what they do out of the kindness of their heart and have no malintent. That said, there are people who we do not speak of their name, as they will legally try to rip your life out from under you. Sadly, in my own personal experience, these are sometimes people that are publicly showing themselves to be caring or sit on ethics boards or deep within our systems. Just be careful and be skeptical. Now, our field does not rise above the human nature of gossip and controversy. We are human. That's okay. If you want it to be, you can live the life of a drama or soap opera, keeping up with the he said, they said, she said in the field. Your best to listen, maybe, and definitely not contribute, but you know, it's up to you. Now, we are pigeonholed. Many may argue against it, but there are few jobs outside the typical funding streams, and you will have to create your own position, most likely, if you're not interested in one of those positions. It's what I did myself. Now, we have a dark and grim history, but the science I have come to learn and love has advanced far beyond behavior modification days. If you want to deep dive, a recent episode of a podcast, Why We Do What We Do, that I am a part founder of, is linked below, covering it in full detail. You can't go to most any general psychology textbook and get an accurate description of our field. There's proof from Ed Morris on this. I've linked it below, and it is so frustrating. In fact, there's no agreed upon principles of behavior. Apparently our field is founded upon them and they're these guiding principles, right? Yet zero agreement as to what these sort of things are happens in our field. Again, I've linked something down below justifying this. Many great things in our field are unfortunately paywall. Books, courses, things like that, videos, whatever it is. I wish this weren't the case, but you're better off knowing this now so that you can budget appropriately. All right, 29, social media is just starting to catch up with the field. We're like in the early days of Facebook and YouTube, like 2007, 8, 9. People are just figuring out what they do, how they work, and so look closely at what people are saying and question why they are saying it. A great example is over 200 people support this channel that you're watching right now this video financially. And while they did not have a say in this video script at all, sometimes they do, and I disclose that with each and every video that may be influenced by somebody else. This is not practiced by everyone in the field, but if you look close, you may be able to figure out more sources of control and influence on someone's behavior. Last and probably most importantly is it's one of the most compassionate communities I've ever experienced. I'm 10 years in and I'm not bored or sick of it yet. Thank you for your time. I'm Ryan O. This is The Daily BA. If you're interested in this content, I have a whole slew more of it, and you can support the channel on patreon.com/thedailyBA. The link is down below. I hope you have a fantastic rest of your day. Make sure you like, share, subscribe. It actually makes a difference, and I will see you in the next one. That's your Daily BA.